probably the biggest commercial fishery existing still in Puget Sound is the chum fishery, a fishery that operates in the fall from basically October and November. Here's a species that there's a little sport fishery on it, but basically it's taken by Indian and non-Indian gillnetters and purse seiners. And we'd like to be able to take the chum salmon, which are quite abundant now and have grown in abundance. There probably runs close to a million now. Very valuable fish, too. It's come on. And we'd like to be able to take it without killing the goose that laid the golden egg. We've got a tremendously valuable sport fishery going on with Chinook and Coho in Puget Sound. And Puget Sound is a growing nursery ground for small Chinook and Coho as they grow on up. We don't want to wipe out that fishery at all. That's very valuable. Also, some of the Chinook and Coho are approaching endangered species categorization. So we want to totally minimize the catch of non-chum fisheries while we're commercially catching the chum salmon, which are available in quite abundance. Now, there's two fisheries that operate out here on the chum salmon, quite different in their methodology, the way they approach it. You've got a gillnet fishery, which basically is a wall of large diamonds of net that fish in the water, that catch fish, migrating fish as they swim into the opening. The opening is slightly smaller than the average girth of the fish. They get into the thing, they can't get back out, and they're, for the most part, dead. This takes directionally migrating fish, mature fish, that are headed to some creek somewhere. You set your net perpendicular to the direction these fish are going in. It's usually a nighttime fishery in Puget Sound, though up in southeast Alaska we get plenty of fish in the daytime fishing with gill nets, and they get stuck and they can't get back out. Now, the net fishes for an hour to two before the guy picks it back up, and so usually those fish are dead when you bring them back in. So you can't just, if you catch the wrong thing, a steelhead or a coho, you can't just turn it loose. And so given that most of them are dead, the Department of Fisheries does allow a gillnetter, while he's catching chum salmon, to keep his incidentally caught Chinook or Coho. Now the purse seine fishery, going back to the gillnet fishery, it's selective in this sense. If I have a large mesh big enough to catch a 9-pound, 10-pound chum salmon, ideal for that size fish, the small fish, something that has something less than the perimeter of that hole in the net, a small fish like a 3 or 4 pound Chinook or Coho salmon or even a 6 pound steelhead will swim right through. So it's self-regulating in that sense. It can be very selective for chum salmon if you put a mesh size, as the department has done with the with the advice of the gillnet fleet and the sound, to put a minimum of a 6 1/4 inch mesh size. You can't use anything smaller than that, so most of the small Chinook and Coho will go right through. And if you look at the data over the years, the landings in the last, say, 15 years since the enactment of the 6 1/4 inch minimum net, the actual catch, the landings of Chinook and Coho per 1,000 chum salmon caught by the gillnet fleet is about 6. For every 1,000 chum salmon caught, only 6 Chinook or Coho are caught and landed. Now, it's also selective in the sense that during the chum salmon season, that's most of the Coho run has gone through. There's not much else around in Puget Sound except these immature feeding Chinook and Coho, which are small, which go through that net. Now, you might say, well, maybe the gillnetters are throwing these things back or whatever. No, they're allowed to land those fish and sell them. So the average size Chinook that the gillnetter might get, or a coho that the gillnetter might get incidentally, even though they're very few, the average size of these fish is about 8 pounds, about the same as the average size chum salmon, and they're going to sell these things. So if you look at the landing figure, you can see that, in fact, Again, I mentioned only of 1,000 chum salmon caught, the gillnet fleet only catches 6 on the average Chinook or coho. All the little ones are going through. Now, selectivity in terms of the other type of gear that's used, the purse seine gear, can work this way. The purse seine has the advantage of being able to hold it. It's a bag that fishes in the water, and then you drag the bag in, and all the fish are essentially alive up to the point that they're brought aboard the boat. So if you have a bag full of but again, the mesh of the seine is like 3.5 inches. So small fish are going to get caught. You're 3 and 4 pound growing Chinook and coho, your little guys in the Sound, which the Sound is full of them. Those fish are going to get caught in the seine, but as long as they're, you know, brought aboard in a very careful way, they're alive. You can potentially throw them back. So, but these fish are small, and they're again not of any great value. So, the seiner doesn't keep them to sell. Tries to throw them back so that they'll swim away and grow. So the seine has the potential of being selective too if you handle the small fish, the immature fish, carefully. There are some problems again with the seine fishery in that you have to operate your gear when you're bringing the fish aboard carefully. You have to right now the department requires the seiners to put the fish in a recovery box and so they swim alive. But again, the seine fishery does have the potential of being highly selective in catching the chum salmon, the target fish, while turning loose the other stuff. Now, comparing the two gears, you have the one gear, the gillnet, which is selective in the fact that the little fish swim right on through. You don't catch them. The seine has the potential of being able to reduce to turn the small fish, the small Chinook and coho, loose alive. Has the potential. The gillnet fishery is self-regulating in its selectivity. The size of the mesh, if you allow a minimum size net, allows the small fish to get through. They're not being handled at all. It does have the disadvantage of every fish that is caught is probably dead. So if you happen to have some big Chinook there, which are from some stock that needs protection, they're going to be dead. Again, I mentioned the fact that the numbers are actually pretty small. But it is self-regulating. Whereas the seine fishery, in order to work effectively in allowing selectivity against those small to protect those small Chinook and coho, the seine fish requires very careful attention to how those fish are handled when they're brought aboard. Now, sometimes those fish happen to be, the little fish could be gilled in a seine fishery. Well, maybe they just died on the way up, and if some guy handles them, pulls them out, and throws them away, and they may still be alive. They've lost a bunch of their scales, but they may still be alive. But if you're going to make that seine fishery selective, not only do you have to release the fish quickly as they come aboard and flop and so forth, but you should put them into recovery boxes, which is what the department tries to enforce. But that whole operation in a real world fishery where guys are trying to make money has to be monitored very carefully. You have to make sure the guys use their recovery boxes. You have to make sure they pick those fish out as they come aboard while they're still alive. And you have to measure the survivability of those fish in those recovery boxes. Or again, I go back to the gillnet operation as it exists in Puget Sound. It is self-regulatory in its selectivity.